What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of The Burn Down. Today we have a special guest, Ruben Stutter.
Coming up next on The Burn Down. What's going on, everybody? This is The Burn Down. I'm Justin.
I'm Eric.
Today we have a very special guest. He's an American gospel singer,
Grammy Award nominee,
contestant on The Biggest Loser, losing 70 pounds.
Huge cigar guy.
And winner of season 2 of American Idol. Ladies and gentlemen, Ruben Stutter.
What's going on, brother?
I'll clap for myself. Yeah, what's happening?
Well, Ruben, thank you very much for joining us on The Burn Down. It's a pleasure to meet you. We appreciate you taking the time out of your day to join us.
Thank you guys for having me. I'm glad you guys brought me on. This is cool.
You, man, it's full circle. It's pretty surreal being a young kid, watching you on TV, and now I got you on my podcast.
That's what's up, man.
Yeah, so, this is cool, man.
Special, thank you.
No, this is really cool. Like Eric said, you know, we followed you. We've watched you on TV, and it's like it's cool to have social media to be able to, you know, we get to meet you virtually, but we get to meet you all through just social media. I mean, it's amazing.
Where are you right now? Where are you?
Right now, I'm in Birmingham, Alabama, on my patio, listening to the birds.
Beautiful. Sounds peaceful.
Yeah. Well, they may not come out because it looks like a cloud. So.
Well, we got plenty of those. I mean, we're up here in New York. We're in my pool house, and we got trees left and right, and the birds love to make appearances on the podcast, so you might hear them from time to time. But
what's up? What part of New York are you guys in?
We're in Long Island right now.
Okay. Yeah. What is that venue in Long Island that we play in? I can't remember.
Paramount?
No, it's like is it a sports venue too?
Nassau Coliseum.
Nassau Coliseum. Yes. Yeah.
Good experience or what? Good experience.
I played there a couple times. Yeah.
Yeah, that was one town over from where I grew up. That's in I think that's in East Meadow or Uniondale,
yeah,
something like that.
That's that Hempstead area. Did you have a good experience at the Nassau Coliseum?
Absolutely. Yeah, I played there a couple of times. The people that work there are really cool people.
Awesome. So I know Justin is itching to ask you this question because this is where he's from. So I'll let him have his moment.
So we're gonna start it at the beginning, and the best place to start in the beginning is where you were born. So you were born in Germany, actually, correct?
I was born in Frankfurt, Germany, on a U.S. Army base. My father was in the military, so I was born there. I think we came back to Birmingham, Alabama, when my mother and I was about maybe 10 months old. Wow. And my father subsequently came after his time of service was done.
Well, thank you for your father for his service, first and foremost.
Yes, thank you.
And he ain't do nothing. I'll tell him for sure.
So have you been back to Germany since then? Or
this is the craziest thing. Like, I have been everywhere around Europe except for Germany.
Really?
And it's so funny because every time I put an album out, I get like all the German radio disc jockeys, like they read that and they're like emailing my record company, like, we got to get him on because he was born here. So I've done interviews with all the DJs and stuff, but I've never been.
Wow, man.
And I was recording in Copenhagen, right? And it's a group over there. They're like really popular producers here, but they live in Copenhagen. Group called DK, and they were like, man, we should write the train to I was like, I'm here to work, like, I don't only here 5 days. Like, it was like, no, you were born there, you haven't been, we should write. I was like, listen, I'll get there. So I plan on going.
I have family there, which is why I asked the question. My grandmother still lives there. I've been there plenty of times. It's an absolutely beautiful country. And I was going to ask if you've ever been to Oktoberfest, and it sounds like you've never been back. So if there's one place you got to go, check out Oktoberfest.
I mean, I've been to Oktoberfest in Birmingham.
It ain't the same, man. No matter where you...
I'm almost positive.
Oh, it is. It's one hell of a...
My dad still has like all his like big like beer mugs and stuff, yep, in his bar house. Like, he still has like all his stuff from Germany.
That's wild.
So what we're going to do, so we have these cigars, and before we, you know, dive into the episode, we have to cut the cigars, we got to light them, spark them up so that we can talk it out while we burn it down. That's our motto.
Yep.
So are you smoking? Do you have a cigar that you're going to...
I do have a cigar, but I'm not going to smoke today. I have to sing later, so I'm kind of...
Oh, okay. Gotcha. So,
are you drinking anything?
I am. Right now, I am drinking... I made a pineapple mojito.
Oh.
With Kurt and Sweeney rum, a dark rum, Kurt and Sweeney, some pineapple, some fresh mint.
So something a little sweet for that sweet voice that you got to put out there.
You know, just, you know, something to like chill out. Because normally I'm a scotch guy, so normally I have like a scotch, you know what I mean? But right now, like today, it's just really nice outside, so I decided to make an actual cocktail. So.
Perfect.
Yeah, something a little fresh. And so we're drinking coffee. One of our favorite cigar pairings is coffee. And we are smoking the Anastasia by Robert Caldwell. So
I've actually had that.
Have you?
You have? So what do you think of it? Because we haven't had it yet.
Never smoked it.
Listen, I'm a huge fan of, I think it's called Long Live the King.
I love that cigar.
It's like one of my favorite sticks. So, I give them a shot. Every time they make a different cigar, I give them a shot. Just because that particular stick is like one of my favorites. Oh,
that's awesome.
Anastasia, I actually had it in a cigar shop in Auburn, Alabama. It was pretty good. A little peppery for me. The Long Live the King is a bit smoother.
Love it.
I feel like. But, I mean, I don't think they make a bad cigar at Caldwell.
No, they certainly don't. I mean, the first one I've ever had of Robert Caldwell is the Blind Man's Bluff. And I love the size of it. I love the creamy texture of it. The flavor is fantastic. The draw is fantastic. So, like you said, I'll always give them a shot.
Always.
And we had a follower of ours recommend this. And I'm surprised you say it's a little pepper. You said this one was peppery or the Long Live the King?
That one to me.
Yeah, so I'm surprised because it doesn't look right off the, you know, it doesn't look peppery, but.
Well, so for some people, like when they smoke Maduros, like to me, I enjoy, I always miss the pepper in Maduros. Does that make sense? Like for me, like the lighter leaves always seem to pack more of a punch for me when I'm smoking them than the darker leaf does. I don't know why that is for my palate.
And that's what we always say, you know, every cigar for everybody is always different. So you might not taste pepper in a Maduro, but we might. But that doesn't mean you're wrong. Doesn't mean we're right. That's just how your palate is used to cigars. So it's an interesting perspective because we usually don't hear that too often. So it's good. It's good to see that what we say actually holds truth.
Right.
So we're gonna cut these real quick. And then we want to ask you a lot of cigar questions, but we gotta be patient and be and get ourselves together. So we'll get right into it, and let's light these up first. Birmingham?
Absolutely. We have, I would say about in the Birmingham metropolitan area, we might have 6 or 7 shops.
Wow.
The one that's closest to me is called the Humidor Room, which is about maybe a mile or so away from my house. And then Cigars and More, they have 4 shops. So they're like the big guys around here. And then we have some smaller, like, you know, like kind of private, kind of like boutique kind of shops that, you know, generally have more of a crowd during like sports seasons.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So you get people that, cause you know, like, the Humidor Room can kind of turn into a club every now and then.
For sure.
Like when you really want to smoke on a weekend, you might want to like go to the ones that's like just for cigars, you know?
Right. No doubt.
But when you want to hang out, you know, my man Saeed that owns the Humidor Room, he has a great bartender. It's a cool vibe. But Cigars and More, they recently just added bars to theirs, but it's more like it's not like cocktails. It's like you're getting a nice pour of Macallan or
you're getting the bottle service.
You're getting that good stuff.
It's not like, you know, you're going to go in there and be like, let me get a Cosmo. No, sir.
No. You got to get that good stuff.
They send you out. Go to the place down the block.
They don't do that.
Walk across the street. You know, we don't make Cosmo.
So to get right into it, Ruben, you know, how did you get into singing? Like, where did it start from?
I mean, just like most people here in the South, most everybody here, white, black, Chinese, or indifferent, we all get started singing in church. Like, that's just how it is down here. Like, the South is, we're all Southerners, we all go to church. And so I started my singing at where I sang for people. Now, I probably sang for my family and my mom and all that stuff a lot, you know, but I started singing for people in church when I was about 5.
Wow, okay. So you young.
I saw my first solo in church when I was 5, and then after that, everybody was like, "Oh, he can sing! Like he's singing solos from now on."
So did you knew you had it, and at a young age, people were telling you, "Listen, you have a voice," and then you're like, "All right, I'm gonna focus on this and really work on my craft."
Really, like I think just like my mom, because my mom and dad were both teachers, I don't think that they never really focused on that. They focused on kind of making me well-rounded. So music was a thing that I did. Like, I sang, but I played football, baseball. I played the tuba. I was on the debate team. Like, my mom was just like, yo, you got to do everything. Until I knew, like, that was going to be. And I think maybe in about 7th grade, I kind of knew, like, all right, I might be a little better than everybody else around. This might be my thing. But before then, like, singing was just like, because everybody sang down here. It wasn't like, people kind of make it seem like, oh, they were singling you out. No. At my church and where I'm from, like, everybody down here sings. Like, it's just the thing that we do. You go to church, you sing.
And you play football.
Yeah, like, even, like, I remember, like, my little football team, like, we had little songs that we would sing, like, you know, I mean, everybody sung stuff down here.
Well, yeah, it's funny, because I always hear, like, when people talk about the South, they always say it's just, like, God, family, football, and singing.
And you played, did you play football at Alabama?
I played at Alabama A&M.
A&M.
You did.
Did you enjoy playing there? How was playing college ball?
You know what? College football became more of a, it was more like a job, bro.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Because you got to wake up. You got to wake up early. You got 2 days. You got 3 days.
Yeah. So I only played in college for one season, and then I auditioned for a music scholarship, and I got a full scholarship the next year in music. So I stopped playing.
Yeah. No. I know what he's talking about with. Because I played college ball too, and it's a job. It's a full time job, especially if you're trying to balance schoolwork and then, you know, everything else. If you have a social life, which you don't really have if you're playing sports. So,
wow.
And it's so funny because it's like, I, as a music major, because I had so many like classes to take, like small 1 hour classes that take up so much time, I still wasn't as busy as I was when I played football.
Wow.
Like, it is a, like, when people say these kids deserve, like, a stipend, like, they deserve
it. Sure.
You know, because, like, you know, I mean, you understand, like, you know, you got a game on Saturday, and then you got, you got papers and stuff to write that are due that Monday. And I went to a smaller school, so we didn't have, like, all this like extra stuff that a lot of the bigger colleges have for their players to help them. Like, you know, you gotta, you know, we had tutoring, but it was like group tutoring. It wasn't like, you know what I mean?
No, so, individual attention.
Yeah. Man.
Wow.
Yeah. It's definitely challenging because not only do you have people think they just see practice and games, but no, there's watching game film. There's working out. There's early morning practices. There's sitting with coaches. There's a ton of stuff that goes behind it.
That was the hardest thing for me, bro, was like the first I can remember vividly, like, my first day at practice. And I remember, like, so they made, like, none of the upperclassmen would give freshmen a ride to the field house, right? So there's, like, everybody, like, so we had to run to the field house. So we ran to the field house, which is, like, a mile away. We get there, and we start working out, like, lifting, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Sure. And then straight from lifting, take a shower, you put your pads on, you go straight out to the field.
I hear you.
And straight from the field, you go from the field to watching film.
Yep.
No, I hear you. Cause, I mean, I didn't play ball in college, but I played football my whole life throughout high school, you know, from fifth grade all the way to high school. But even in high school, it was two-a-days, three-a-days. Then during school, you had to be at the school before class started. And then you had an hour to review film, and then you had to go right to class. And after school, you had practice. Then you have a paper due, but you can't go to the paper because you got to go meet the coach or watch individual film. And it's a lot of work.
Bro, but it's different when they don't have to let you go.
Right, because it's like, especially if you're on scholarship, yeah. It's like, listen, we're paying for you to go here. We own you.
Yeah,
sure. In high school, they have to, like, let you leave. Like, in college, when you're watching film, you're watching film. Like, if the film is on at 7, you're in there at 11 o'clock, period.
Oh, yeah. No oh, God. Yeah.
Damn.
Oh, yeah. So you basically said, all right, fuck football. I'm singing.
Yeah.
Screw this shit. I'm not watching film for 4 hours. I'm going to go sing.
Yeah, it's a little bit.
Because I feel like whatever I do, I have to love it. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want to spend 4 years in college, like, miserable.
Yeah.
And not that I didn't have fun playing football. It just was not, I could tell, I didn't feel the same way I felt in the music room that I felt on the practice field.
Definitely. Right. It's good that you picked up on that. I mean, you got to do what you got to love.
Yeah.
So you said that you got 5 cigars with you. You got a few of your favorite cigars. So one of the questions we definitely want to ask you was, what are your favorite cigars?
Okay. Well, I have one of them here. And everybody's probably going to be like, oh, that's a bull, because it's like...
No, man.
Not here.
It's your cigar. Your favorite is your favorite. I mean, there's no judgment.
My favorite cigar, hands down, is the Fuente Opus X.
Boom.
Oh, come on, boom, man. That's beautiful.
Boom.
Like,
love to see it.
And so here's the story. Like, when I first got into cigars, which was like right after I won American Idol, one of the guys that was like a rep of mine bought me like a celebratory box of cigars. And he bought me a box of Arturo Fuente short stories.
Beautiful. Good stick.
And I never had a cigar before. Like, that was my introduction to cigars.
Wow, that's a little on the strong side for an introduction, but.
But I the first one I hated. And I called him. I was like, man, I don't like this. He said, man, no. I'll come down the next, because he was like, when you come to New York, bring the box with you. I brought the box. He was like, we're going to go to a shop. So we went to this. I can't even remember the name of the shop right now. But we went to a shop, and we smoked one. He said, man, just chill out and enjoy yourself. Like, don't think about anything. Like, let's just enjoy it. And I, like, from that point on, I have been a fan of cigars. Like, it's been, like, my secret kind of, like, hobby.
Love it.
So that's one of my favorites. Another one of my favorites is this Special 52 by Davidoff.
Wow. Another great stick. Absolutely. Man, you got some good sticks there.
Those are some high powerful sticks.
53, not 52, 53.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful.
And I'm a fan of Davidoff's, but I think they do a better job on their limited edition sticks.
Yeah.
Than they do on, like, their everyday smoke.
Sure.
Have you ever had the chef's edition?
Yeah, so one of my friends is a chef, and he put me on the chef's edition. All he really smokes is Davidoff. That's like that's it. But he put me on the chef's edition. But I like this one, and this Cohiba Royale.
Oh no, you got three solid smokes.
I mean, dude, you're smoking good down in Birmingham.
Oh yeah.
I don't know what people are thinking, but you're smoking good.
So in the conference that I play in my school's conference is called the SWAC, the Southwestern Athletic Conference. Mm-hmm. It's also the conference that Michael Strahan played in, that Jerry Rice, a lot of players, but a guy that went to one of our competing schools, Grambling, he reps this cigar, and he introduced me to it, Sean Williams, and he got sent this to me, and I enjoy it. I have smoked like five or six of them, and I had to slow myself down because I only had 10 or 12. So I had to all right, you might want to hold up. So I actually ordered some more so I wouldn't be out of them. But this is a really good stick.
Wow.
Man, he's smoking good down in Bama. Yeah,
that's a phenomenal top three. I mean, I was not expecting the Opus to dab it off.
Yeah, when you said people are going to say blah, blah, blah. I thought it was going to
like a Romeo and Juliet or something, which is still a good cigar, but I was not expecting an Opus X.
Opus X is definitely one of our favorites. I know we love the Lost City Opus X. Man. Fantastic. Yeah, fantastic stick. And then another one is the 20th year God's Whisper.
Mm.
That's another, the Blue Label, fantastic smoke.
Have you guys been to the shop in Vegas?
I have. Casa de Fuente?
Not me.
Oh, man. Look, that's how I got on the pineapple mojitos.
Really?
Please tell us.
Yeah, they made one in there, and I was like, oh, this is slamming. I got to have it.
This is my new drink now.
Right.
So you drank the pineapple mojito with the Opus X?
Yeah, but another honorable mention, and I just don't have any with me, but they're so hard to find these days, is Atabey.
Oh, ooh,
wow. You do know your cigars.
You know your cigars.
Because when I asked you, are you a cigar guy, you said, I'm a cigar guy. I just didn't know what kind of level of cigar guy you were. And, I mean, you're up there. You're way up there.
Atabey is killer. United Cigars made a phenomenal smoke with Atabey.
Yeah,
we've gotten it with a subscription service. Luxury Cigar Club sent us our first Atabey,
mm-hmm.
and we smoked it on a podcast and blew our hair back. Fantastic stick.
They are hard to find though.
When they come to burn, listen. I had the guy at Cigars of Mars said, listen, you got to call me when they come. Like if you're not there within the 2 hours of them opening the box, you're dead.
Oh yeah, oh yeah.
You need the first dibs. You need it because once they get in the shop, they're gone.
Yeah, you're dead. They're out of there.
That's like the there was two other cigars in our local shop called Matadors here in Long Island. There was the Drew Estate Feral Pig,
mm-hmm.
and the LaFleur, the LFD Andalusian Bull. Those two cigars.
I almost brought a bull out today.
Oh, dude, he knows his shit, man.
You do know
your Those man. Two cigars, same thing. You open the box. I was there once because I was there after work. I went in. I had a cigar. They just opened the box, and I got there like 5 o'clock, and by 6:30, the box was gone.
And okay.
Just opened
now, I'm going to ask you guys a question. Do you feel like they changed the blend?
Yes.
At the losing bull?
From the first time to the second time I tried it, 100%.
Yes.
What is that about, bro?
So I'll tell you. So this is the theory, and I don't know if it actually happened, but this is my theory: is that when a cigar gets rated in the top, let's say five, or this one actually won Cigar of the Year, Andalusian Bull. I forgot what year it was, but it won in the last a few years ago. When a cigar wins the Cigar of the Year. Everybody and their grandmother wants to get the cigar.
Yes.
So it starts flying off the shelves, and then the company can't keep up with the demand. So the quality of the product starts to diminish because they're trying to pump out so many to keep up with the demand, and then the flavor starts going down with it. That's my theory. I don't know if it's true, but
I
agree with you. It's when it first came out and it won Cigar of the Year, it was fantastic. And then it started to...
Yeah, I kind of hate that I smoked all the ones that I had when the first batch came out because now it's I can't even remember how out, and I have some friends in my cigar club like that are holding on to, like, like one of my partners has a box from, like, back in the day in his humidor. He was like, yeah, I'm gonna wait like 5 years so y'all could give me like $100 a stick for you.
I mean, another thing I can think of too is that it's kind of like wine, where the same wine from year to year might taste different because of the climate. Because when you're, you know, same thing with tobacco leaves, is the climate's not exactly the same every single year. So the climate could change, but with cigars, you know, change from year to year, I don't know, because they probably harvest a lot of the leaves and have a big collection of them. But change from year to like 6 years later, I can see that. Yeah. So
as we stay, as we were saying earlier, you know, we're about, you know, mindset, positive, inspiration. And a question I have for you, just because I just like to know people's mindsets when they're about to embark on something huge, is getting off of cigars real quick. You know, right before you were on American Idol, like you were about to set the stage, how did you prepare? How did you get your mind? How did you get the mindset to like get in the mode?
I will always like find a quiet corner. Because you have to understand, when we take the show, of course it was a live audience, and it's pandemonium in the audience. Like, you can hear the guy that's pumping the crowd up before Ryan Seacrest comes out. He's like making them dance and do all this kind of stuff. So like and you kind of see a little panic on everybody's face. And what I normally did was just go in a corner and just like say positive affirmations, like, I deserve to be here. I'm a winner. I can do, and I would always, like, this scripture my grandmother taught me, that I can do all things through Christ that gives me strength. I would say that.
Oh yeah, love it.
Like, I would just say it over and over again, and it worked. Like, I would always go on stage with laser focus. I was never scared when the camera came on. And I subsequently ended up winning.
I love that. That's
The only time I was actually nervous on the show is when I didn't have to sing. And that was when I was standing there if I was going to go to the next round or not. But the singing part was, I was always like, oh, I got this.
Yeah. I mean, now that you say it and watching it, because I rewatched it again, I mean, you just walked up on there and just crushed it. I mean, it wasn't even the hesitation.
Knocked it out the park.
They're like, all right, sing. And you're like, all right, let me do it.
All right, go for it. Oh, so long
for this night I prayed. And you just crushed it. So it's cool to hear how you developed that mindset and how you prepared just to go right into it.
I love that, man. I love the positive affirmation. And I love that scripture. It's one of my favorite scriptures. That's Philippians, right? I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I love that. And that's one of our big things, is positive affirmations as well, is just, you know, so many people you talk about, you know, there's a lot of inspirational speakers out there. They try to inspire others and they give others motivation. But the key thing is inspiring yourself. And how do you talk to yourself, right? Yeah. Because you have thousands, if not millions, of conversations every single day. And 99% of those conversations are in your own head with yourself. Absolutely. So how are you speaking to yourself? Are you hyping yourself up? Are you telling yourself you can do stuff? So I love that. That is 100.
That is 100. I mean, because we talk about it all the time. And again, it's cool to hear how other people do it and see successful people do it, because it's not just nonsense that it works every single day. I mean, both of us, we write positive affirmations down, goals down, just because you got to be in that mindset. You got to be able to control the day. And it's very, very cool to hear that. So kudos to you.
Thank you, sir.
So we're going to kind of spin off of that. And one thing that we've been doing lately on our episodes is we have a quote of the day. And today's quote of the day, Eric found from you, actually. It's only fitting. Ruben Studdard is on our podcast. We're going to do a quote from Ruben Studdard as the quote of the day. So, Eric, why don't you read off the quote of the day?
All right. Let me read it here real quick. And so what you have here, it says, it really doesn't bother me. I just do my thing and God has a plan for me. And I mean, what we say is like, we're just going to do our own thing. I mean, you really can't hear the outside noise. You really can't worry about what other people are doing. You just got to do your own thing and things will happen. So that is our quote of the day, which is, it really doesn't bother me. I just do my thing and God has a plan for me.
Right. And as long as people, if you live your life understanding that only you and God can determine what happens to you.
Mm-hmm.
Other people saying things, other people having their opinion. Like, you have no idea as a kid how many people probably hated on me being a singer or hated on me, like, saying that I was going to be famous. Like, I said it all the time. I was like, yo, I'm going to be famous. Like, just so you know. Like, whatever. You know what I mean? But now, like, you know, when people see that I've actually accomplished the goal that I set out to accomplish, it's like, you know, you have to believe in yourself first.
And it's like to you, you're like, people are like, wow, you accomplished your goal. You're like, yeah, I knew I was going to do this. Like, I've been saying it since I was a kid. Like, it's no surprise to me. I knew where I was going.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I mean, you know, if people don't understand, I got a lot of no's from the exact same companies that I ended up being signed to after American Idol. Like, I got no's, you know, it wasn't like, I wasn't out here trying before that. It was just that I kept at it. Like, I never let an opportunity slip or, you know, didn't chase my dreams because I was deflated. I never got deflated. I knew I was supposed to be doing what I'm doing.
Man. And I love that. It's like, somebody had told this to me once too. It's almost like driving in a car. Like, if you're going, let's say you get in your car and you're going to, I don't know, let's say you're making a road trip. We're in New York. Let's say we're going upstate to Buffalo, right? And you have your GPS on and you know 100% fact that you're getting to Buffalo. Like, no matter how you got to go there,
yeah.
Whether you got to go around a detour, you got to go this way, you know that you're getting there. Like, there's not a shadow of a doubt. It's 100% faith that I'm going to get to Buffalo. So it's the same thing. It's like, if you know where you're going and you just have faith, you, no matter what you do, if you have to go around this way, you hit a bump, you hit a speed bump, you have a detour, doesn't matter. You know 100% I'm getting there. So when you arrive, it's no surprise. Like, I knew I'd said it all along. Yeah. I knew I was going there.
So spinning off of that, being that, you know, you already in your mind, you had your positive affirmations of I'm already going to do it. I'm already going to crush it. I am the best. You know, when you performed and all three judges were like,
Ruben, you have a very nice voice.
Thank you.
Very good voice.
Mm-hmm. Randy, what
I
do you
think very good voice as well.
What was like going through your mind? You're like, I knew I would do this.
I was number one excited because it was like finally like the stamp. Like I something in me felt like this was gonna be my thing.
Yeah.
Like, and I knew when I heard I was going to Hollywood, I was like either gonna be in the top 10 or I was gonna win. Either way, I was gonna make it. And at that moment I was happy because my brother was with me and my brother was my rider. Like, my brother was always my supporter. Like, awesome. Even when I, like, he put money up for me to record one of my first demos. Like, when I decided to leave college, like, my brother was my, even when like other family members weren't, my brother was my guy. So to have him there with me.
Probably amazing.
Birmingham, Alabama, represent Birmingham. I just like to say hello to my mama. I love you, mama. Thank you for being so supportive to me my whole life. This is my brother. And to my dad, I love you too. Birmingham, we're on our way back home, and I'm going to Hollywood.
It was an amazing feeling. And, you know, like, that's the memory that I have now because my brother has subsequently left this earth. He's no longer with us, but.
Oh, I'm sorry to hear that.
Thank you, guys. But he was always my biggest fan. And, like, to have him be as excited as I was that day because he was invested. You know what I mean? It wasn't like.
That's your blood, too. That's someone you grew up with your whole life.
Yeah, but he was. He had also put his money down. He put his money where his mouth was. It wasn't like he was like, yo, I think you good and keep at it. He was like, nah, here's you know, $1,500 for you to go to the studio.
That's awesome.
So you put up some money. I mean, you know, when back then when it's you know, that may be like the only thing that you have, or that's the, you know, when you haven't achieved the success that you know you're going to achieve yet, you're still in the beginning. That $1,500 is a lot of money.
Yeah, man. He was, I mean, he drove me to the audition.
I mean, yeah, at the end of the video, I mean, you guys are like hugging each other. And I mean, I got two brothers, so I put myself in those shoes, being like, man, if I was in that situation, we'd be hyped, we'd be going nuts. So that's a really cool memory, and it's cool that you said it's not even that, you know, these judges said you're good. It was the fact that you remember that your brother was there and you guys celebrated together, which is awesome.
So you make it to Hollywood, right? What was the journey like from that first time in Hollywood up until the season finale when you finally won? How was that journey? The
funny thing about making it to Hollywood is that you're around all these people that in their mind are stars before the show. So it's like, I kind of kept to myself for the most part. Like, I didn't really like click up with people or any of that. I kind of like
did your own thing.
I just paid attention mostly. And I also watched Clay do the same thing.
You were there. You were there. You weren't there to socialize. You were there to work.
Nah, I was working.
I'm here to do a thing. And that's it.
Yeah, man. Like, it was, you know, like the whole thing. I mean, because, you know, you can imagine what the atmosphere was like. You got a bunch of like 23 to 18 year olds that they've shipped off to Hollywood. It's like a big frat party.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? And so, like, the people that are able to focus in on what they're there for are the ones you undoubtedly saw in the finale or in the like, subsequent, like, top 24 and stuff like that. Like, you know, because they're – I mean, to be perfectly honest, I heard some people there that could sing better than me, for sure.
They just got distracted.
Absolutely. Like, it wasn't, like, a lack of people on there, because like, it's a talent show, so it was – a lot of talented people there.
It's kind of like, and I'm misquoting it, but it's kind of like that quote. It's like, you know, you don't have to be the best. You just have to be the hardest working in the room. That type of mentality.
Yeah, that's the quote that says, I know it. Hard work beats talent when talent doesn't work hard.
Exactly.
Yep.
There you go. Because I understand what you're saying, because, I mean, I can't speak for Justin, but when I've been in situations where there's a lot of people, same skill set, same mindset, and you see other people kind of just getting distracted and you're there for one sole purpose, I'm the same type of way. It's kind of like, well, I'm only here for really one reason. I got to be focused on what to do. I can't really get involved in distractions because that's not what I'm here for.
Yeah.
I love that. So one of the questions I want to ask you is that, so growing up, you know, obviously, you've probably listened, you know, you probably had people that you listened to, people that you still listen to. Who is your favorite artist, and do you have a favorite song of all time?
My favorite singer, period, is probably somebody you guys have never heard of. His name is Marvin L. Winans.
Marvin L. Winans.
I'm sure you've heard of the gospel group, the Winans.
I can't say I have.
Yeah.
I can't say I have.
Well, Marvin Winans is the older brother of that. Well, he's the second oldest brother. And he is one of my favorites. Fred Hammond is also one of my favorites. And Donny Hathaway.
I know Donny Hathaway.
Okay.
But when I was a kid, I liked all the stuff that kids like. I mean, I love New Edition. Like, that was my group. Like, I couldn't.
Of course.
I hate, like, doing these interviews without, like, giving them shout-outs because, like, I feel like it's a generation of singers that wouldn't be around if it wasn't for us seeing kids their age.
Right.
You know what I mean? I mean, they didn't look much older than us. You know what I mean? So seeing them do their thing, I think, inspired us to say, oh, we can do that too. You know what I mean?
Right, right. So now I'm actually going to extrapolate on the second question I had, which was, what was your favorite song? But maybe it's the same song, maybe they're different songs, but what's your favorite song to listen to, your favorite song growing up, and then what's your favorite song to sing?
My favorite song to listen to is a song by Donny Hathaway called A Song For You.
Song for You. We're going to have to play a clip right now, that song.
Yeah, do something.
My favorite song. You said my favorite song to sing or listen to?
To sing.
My favorite song to sing is probably Flying Without Wings, because it always reminds me, like, yo, you won.
It rings, I'm flying without wings.
Like,
you made it.
Like, so when people are like, and it's so funny, like, I rarely do it on concerts, but when I get a chance to sing it, I'm always like smiling and excited, because it just takes me right back to the moment when I won American Idol.
Wow. It's just, so, it's like the feeling that it gives you, right?
Yeah.
Now, how did you transition from where you were into now gospel singing? How did you make that transition?
Well, so people, gospel is just a genre of music. I made a gospel album, and everybody's like, oh, he's a gospel artist now. No, I'm a singer, and I sing all kinds of music.
You got to talk to Google. You got to talk to Google. You Google yourself, and it's American gospel singer.
Right. It's so hard to get them to change stuff, like, but it doesn't matter. I'll be whatever they want me to be.
Yeah.
But I grew up singing gospel. I grew up singing everything, but I felt like, because gospel is my roots, I had to like do an album to pay tribute to all those people that were like influential to me musically. Like, cause before I had like secular albums, all the songs I knew was like, Yes, Jesus Loves Me and Jesus Loves the Little Children. Like, I mean, like those are like, you know, so like, for, like you can't, I feel like you're being inauthentic if you don't, appreciate where you come from.
Absolutely.
Celebrate where you come from. Like, being a Christian is a part of who I am. And so for me, like, doing that album just for me lets the world know, like, yeah, I sing these, you know, bedroom ballads and all this stuff, but I still love Jesus.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me of like one of the things that I heard from somebody along the lines of gospel and Christianity. It says that your talent is God's gift to you, and what you do with that talent is your gift back to God. So it's almost like, you know, God gave you this beautiful gift of singing, and now going back to your roots, your Christian roots, putting out a gospel album is like your gift back to God, saying, yeah, listen, thank you for this beautiful gift. Thank you for, you know, guiding me and strengthening me to achieve my goals. And I love it.
And without like trying to be braggy, it's like, it was like one of the highest selling gospel albums of all time.
Brag mm-hmm. about it. Brag about it.
This
man.
Is your, this is an interview about you, man. This is a time for you about to, it. Don't be humble. Brag, baby.
You know, the thing that was so crazy was, is like, I was shocked because I literally was like, okay, I just did my first album. I want to do this gospel album so my gospel people can know I still love y'all. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
Like, I'm still the same kid that was like singing in the church with y'all. Like, yeah. So I did it, and people like went bananas. Like, and I have to give God the glory for that, because I mean, like, even to this day, like, that I Need an Angel single is still like I get people writing me letters saying how much that song like helped them through like bad situations. And so for me, I knew it really didn't have anything to do with me. Like, that was God engineering.
Absolutely. Mm. That's awesome, man.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because from what I understand, I mean, you're a big Luther Vandross guy. I mean,
yeah.
Are you doing something?
Here's the thing. My mom is the Luther Vandross fanatic, okay?
Whew.
And it used to drive me crazy as a young adult that people used to go, oh, he just reminds me so much of Luther. I was like, oh, here we go.
I mean, not a bad person to be compared to, but.
No, but I you know, at that point, I kind of wanted to just be like, I wanted people to be like, oh, it's Ruben.
Yeah,
right. No, I get you. I get you.
Yeah, but now that, the past 3 years, I've been doing a tour called Ruben Sings Luther, and it has been like crazy. When I say crazy, like
crazy how?
These crazy. And I'm so thankful that, you know, for my mom, because I would have never knew all I know all of this material because of my mom being such a huge fan of Luther Vandross.
Sure.
And I'm like a sponge. So if I hear some music, it'll take me a while to forget it. And growing up in the house with her, that's what she played all the time. She played Luther Vandross all the time. So for me, when I stepped into the, and I actually, like when I was a kid, she actually took me to his concert. I didn't want to go, but she made me go. But now I do the exact same concert.
Isn't that wild?
It comes full circle. It's amazing how it happens, right?
I copied the exact. So I went, when I got ready to do Reuben Sings Luther, I went to my mom's house and she has a VHS tape of the tour that she went to.
Don't tell me she compared both of you on a TV.
At some parts of the show, you can absolutely do that. Like we do the exact same. It's like a Broadway performance.
Wow, that's awesome.
So let me ask you this. So are you still doing Reuben Does Luther or Reuben Sings Luther?
Absolutely. I mean, we can't now because you know it's COVID.
Well, yeah, but I mean, is the tour was on hold? But are you, is that tour coming down, coming to New York? Are you coming back to the Coliseum or?
We've been to New York like four times. We did. Go on RubenSingsLuther.com and look at the past shows and you'll see it. Like, I mean, we've done New York several times already, but we'll be back.
Because when you're coming back, we got to come see you. That's,
yeah, that'd be sick.
We got to come check you out. I mean,
now we know you, so.
Y'all got to come check me out. Let's see here.
Now, how has it been with the whole coronavirus stuff? How is that? How you dealing with like tours and stuff like that? What's like the good word with that?
We're at home. So, we were at Sony Hall in New York.
Okay.
We were, go down. We were at the Lehman Center for the Performing Arts in the Bronx.
Okay. Know that place. Yep.
Go down. We were at Mayo Performing Arts Center in Morristown, New Jersey.
Okay. It's not too far.
The Borgata, Atlantic City.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Know that place. Been there.
We were at the Bergen Performing Arts in Inglewood.
All right, that's just over the bridge, Inglewood, New Jersey. It's a nice
St. George Theater in Staten Island.
So you showed a lot of love to the people in New Jersey and New York.
Yeah, we got it.
We literally have been all up and down the Eastern State Theater in New Jersey.
We got to go. We got to check them out. Next time.
NYCB Theater in Westbury, wherever that is.
I know that place.
Yeah, that's Long Island.
That's Long Island. That's not 20 minutes from us.
Yeah, it's not too far from here. Yeah, I mean, it's going to be interesting, you know, concerts and stuff. We'll see how that stuff plays out. I don't really want to talk about it because that's all we hear about. Yeah. But.
We'll have to see, man. Like, yeah. I want everybody to be safe. At the end of the day, like, once we'll get back to it when everybody can come and be comfortable and not have to worry about contracting the coronavirus at a concert.
Right.
Do you have any crazy concert stories? Like, you know, someone jumping on stage?
Yeah. What's the craziest concert story?
The craziest stuff in my touring career happened when I was on American Idol tour.
So what was like the most memorable, craziest thing that you've seen on American Idol?
The America, I remember we were in Minneapolis at the Mall of America, and we all went to buy camcorders. Remember when everybody wanted like...
Yeah, of course.
So they had just came out with the camcorder with the thing that flips out on the side. So we all wanted to buy one so we could record our experience on tour, and we went in the mall, and we were in there 20 minutes in Radio Shack, and the mall shut down.
Oh, my
God. Oh.
Like we had, like they had to like take us out. So, cause I worked in the mall in high school. So I knew about those like back hallways behind the stores.
Yeah, of course.
They had to take us out through one of those back hallways in the Mall of America to get us back to our like SUVs and stuff to go back to the University of Minnesota for rehearsal.
Wow.
That was crazy. Clay and I were doing like our like winner runner up kind of situation, like when we were doing like all the talk shows, and I think we were coming out of like BB King's in Manhattan, like in Times Square, and it was like pandemonium.
Well, Times Square itself is just pandemonium in general. I can't imagine when it's,
I think we were like trying to be like regular,
try to fit in.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So we were trying to like kind of walk and be cool. and somebody spotted he and I together walking. It was like, ah! And we had to run back in BB King's.
Oh, yeah.
The first time I came home, though, after I won, a lady jumped on my neck, and the state troopers had to, like, pry her off of me. It was crazy.
What? No, what do you mean jump on your neck? Like, she, like, threw herself at you?
She was in front of me, and she was like, I think she was, like, going to give me a hug, but instead she, like, hugged me and wrapped around. She was an older lady. She was, like, in her 60s. Like, she was older.
She felt young right. She felt young right then and there.
She straddled you.
But she felt young that day.
Yeah, exactly. Wow. All right. So to get into more cigars now. Now you said your first cigar was a Fuente after you won American Idol.
Yeah.
Now, so you had that first cigar, and you said it wasn't that good. How did you develop a liking for cigars? How did you like get more and more into cigars? Was it more for celebratory reasons, or you just liked the way it felt?
Yeah, because you said that you smoked the short story, then you had it again and started liking it. So what was the journey after that?
I mean, they started being more like a celebratory kind of situation. So like if it'll be my birthday, I would buy a box of cigars for myself.
Yeah.
And I would smoke them because nobody else would smoke with me.
We'll smoke with you.
Yeah, I mean, we'll have
come up to New York. We're going to smoke with you.
I'll be happy to go to Birmingham. I've never been to Alabama before.
Let's go.
And so for me, it's like I can only do it when I'm off the road and I don't have subsequent shows coming up. So I have to have like a week between, like if I want to smoke some cigars, like I have to have a week where I can't, you know.
Right, because you got to sing. You got to sing, obviously.
Right. But, I mean, it started off as really just celebratory, kind of like, you know, going to the cigar shop, not really knowing what I was asking for. And then I think about maybe 8 years ago, 9 years ago, I really started to get into like different cigars and what the blends were and what made them the cigar that they are. Like, mm-hmm. And I started just, you know, buying more cigars. Like, cause once you get into it, like it becomes like
it's an addiction.
Yep.
A part of your budget. So
yes.
That's a perfect way of putting it.
I have 1, 2, 3, 4 humidors now.
Wow, awesome.
All packed, I'm assuming.
Well, the fourth one is just for the boxes, of course. The kind of like, you know, the refrigerator looking kind of.
Yeah, yeah. The where you keep those and you age them, let them sit.
Right. And then the other three are just like, you know, when I buy single sticks, I put them in there and,
you know. Now, when you're smoking a cigar, you know, you obviously just said it's for, you know, you used to do it for celebratory reasons. But now when you're smoking a cigar, you know, what does it mean to you? Is it a way to collect your thoughts? Is it a way just to relax?
It's my relaxation time, man. When I come home, I come out on my patio and I turn on the Wynn Marcellus CD. I say CD, but of course, iTunes.
Yeah. We got you. We have CDs. We got you.
And I'll sit back and have a cigar, man, and just listen to my music because it helps me decompress.
Mm.
I generally always have my cigars at the end of the day. So it's not like, I have had cigars when I'm on vacation, like after breakfast with coffee and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I enjoy them more at the end of the day when the sun is going down, I can like enjoy my music and my cigar.
Mm. No, we feel you on that one because that's definitely one of the things that we think about when we're smoking cigars is it's a time to be at one with your own thoughts. It's a time to recharge batteries.
Sure.
Sorry. Bring yourself back to neutral. Like you said, decompress and kind of forget about everything else. Just be in the moment, listening to music, relaxing.
That's what it's all about.
It's the cheapest form of therapy. That's what we say.
Yeah. The cheapest form of therapy. That's a fact. I mean, but do you smoke cigars with anybody? Do you have a family member or a friend?
I'm actually a member of a cigar club here in Birmingham. We're called Cigar Men of Distinction.
Cigar.
So, you know, we smoke cigars together, but I generally just smoke them. I have like now that I'm a cigar smoker, like I have friends that are now like cigar smokers.
Yeah. Yeah. You find out quickly who the cigar smokers are, and you start surrounding yourself with those people.
You know, but it's so fatty now. Like everybody wants to go to a cigar shop and kind of hang out, and you know, look cool. You know what I mean? You could always tell when it's like a new guy in there because he's like smoking an acid.
Love it. I love it.
A Java mint or a latte, right?
Java mint latte, passion fruit acid.
And you can smell it right away, yeah. Too. You know from a... He could be sitting 20 feet away from you like, that guy's smoking a
freaking... Or someone smoking a cigar and they're like...
Hey, and they're in the cigar club trying to look hard and tough with the like Java mint. Like,
boy, you don't even know what you're smoking.
Yeah, you don't even know what you're doing.
That's awesome.
So... So you're talking about like you have your group that you smoke with, right? And now you start having, as a cigar smoker, you befriend people that are fellow cigar smokers. But if you could smoke a cigar with anybody, dead or alive, who would it be?
Michael Jordan.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. Let's go.
Now that's a good one.
That's a good one. That would definitely, that's up on my, I would smoke Michael Jordan. I mean, I was a basketball guy. We talked about playing college ball. I was a basketball nut. So Michael Jordan is up on that list.
Have you ever met Michael Jordan?
I have, like, in passing, kind of like, what's up kind of situation.
Did you, I'm sure you watched a documentary.
I did. But so, like, I was like, you know, Michael played baseball here.
Mm-hmm.
So
yep.
I was, like, in my formative years, like, when he was playing for the Barons. So all of us were doing all we can to get a glimpse of Michael Jordan back then. Like, I mean, I remember going to, back in the day, we had a shoe store here that was called Just for Feet. And he was doing an autograph signing there. And I like tried to go out there and the line was a mile down the street. It was so crazy.
I can imagine. I mean,
but I did get a chance. I did get a chance to see him play with the Barons, so I guess that counts. You know,
did you get a chance to see him play basketball?
Yeah, he actually played an exhibition game here in Birmingham with the Bulls one time, and I got a chance to see him play.
Yeah, he was.
He only played like 2 minutes though.
Yeah, but that was probably a spectacular 2 minutes, wasn't it?
Yeah, like you know, it was an exhibition game, so it was like they were playing like the Denver Nuggets or something, and they weren't that good back then.
I mean, hey, you saw him play. A win's a win in my eyes.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now I don't think we asked, but you said you had, you know, the pineapple mojito with a cigar. But do you have you drink scotch, as you said. Do you have a particular cigar pairing that you like when you smoke a cigar?
I don't, man. I don't. I'm not beholden to any particular kind of alcohol. It's just really what I'm feeling like. If I want some scotch, I'll have a scotch. If I want rum, I'll have rum. If I want a cognac, I'll have a cognac. If I want to drink a beer, I'll have a beer. Like, I'm not one of the people that have to be like, well, cigars are only good with this.
Yeah.
Like, it's my choice. Like, if I want a cigar and a Coca-Cola, I'm cool with that.
Yeah. No, amen to that, right?
I couldn't say it better myself. I mean, in my opinion, there's nothing wrong with just saying I like a cigar or bourbon, but in my eyes, you're not really expanding your horizons and enjoying the other experiences that you can with other different pairings. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and certain cigars will pair better with different things, right? Yeah. Like if you have a mild, creamy, nutty flavor, it's probably going to pair very well with coffee. If you have something that's like a pepper bomb, you probably like it with scotch or bourbon, right? Yeah. And certain things are going to pair well with certain beverages. So definitely, like you said, just expand your horizon, try all different things. But
my one of the questions that I also wanted to ask was, how did you come across us on Instagram? Because you actually followed me on my birthday, so thank you for that. That was a great birthday present.
I'm always looking for cigar pages, and okay. So like that was like I saw that. I was like, oh, these guys seem cool.
Oh, that's awesome, man.
Well, we appreciate the follow. Thank you very much.
I mean, I was celebrating my birthday. I was like, I think Ruben Stutter just followed me, and everyone was like, what? And they're like, no way. And I was like, yeah. I'm like, look, he got the blue check mark and everything. He said, I just messaged him. He said he's a cigar guy. And I was like, wow. I was like, I don't think there's any better guest that we need to have on right now. I have to ask him. So that's awesome.
Dude, you said it to me too. And I was like, no shit. And then I checked my Instagram. I'm like, oh, fuck, he followed me too. Like, so, like, damn, this is cool as shit right now.
And that's awesome because Ed Reed, Hall of Fame football player for the Baltimore Ravens, said the same thing. He followed us and followed me. And I asked him, I said, you know, how did you come across? He's like, hey, man, I just like to look for cigar pages because I'm not sure if you know, but he's a huge cigar guy too as well. So it's, you know, it's kind of cool how social media kind of puts people together. So I appreciate you, you know, giving us a follow and obviously being on here. But it's just cool to see that putting up pictures and taking time actually works because people appreciate it.
No doubt, guys. And I appreciate you guys having me on. Right now, I got to take a call from my mom, so I'm going to have to let y'all ride.
Of course, man. Thank you so much for being on, Ruben. We really appreciate it. And thank you just for taking the time to hang out and smoke a cigar with us.
No doubt, guys. Have a good one.
All right. Take care, Ruben.